Welcome everybody. Today I'm glad to have Alex May as the speaker of this seminar. Alex May did his PhD in computer science at ETH Zurich and Paderborn University. He was then appointed as assistant professor at TU Darmstadt and then at Bochum University in 2017. And he's currently there, the head of the computer science department. The main interests of Alex are all aspects of cryptanalysis, including codes, lattices, and quantum algorithms. He's the co-author of more than 20 papers, the main cryptographic avenues, among them, some works, including the fastest known decoding algorithms. Currently, he's a member of CASA, which is the German Excellence Cluster in Cybersecurity. And today, he's going to review the advances in decoding linear codes within the last decade and how they affect current coding-based crypto system in the NIST standardization process. Before starting with the talk, I would like to remember the audience that we have a Q&A chat where you can ask any question. Alex will try to answer all of them during his talk, but in any case, once he finishes, we will take a look and make sure that all the questions can be answered. So that's it. Alex, the stage is yours.
So thank you very much, Santos, and thank you very much for the kind introduction and giving me the opportunity to speak in this TII seminar. I'm also closely collaborating with the TII cryptanalysis group at the moment. So today this talk is a survey talk of what was going on in decoding algorithms within the last decade and how they affect code-based crypto systems. So I don't want to go too deep into detail. So the whole talk is supposed to be understandable from the first to the last, and that's the 20th slide. So please feel free to interrupt me at any point of view if something is unclear and if I forgot to define something properly and so on. Okay, so let's have a start. So this is about decoding. I hope you can see my mouse pointer. And yes, okay. So let's first define what a linear code is. So here's a very mathematical definition. A linear code is a k-dimensional subspace of F2n. So that means all vectors have length n, and we have 2 to the k vectors of this form. And computer scientists would say, okay, we generate this code by the generator matrix. And here's a generator matrix. So it's a K times N matrix. And I take the linear span of the rows of this matrix, and then I get 2 to the K possibilities, and that defines my code. And this is in fact already the point for cryptography. So we have a very efficient way of representing an exponential amount of vectors, namely the linear span of this generator matrix. And this is kind of the key, because we have such a compact representation, which only takes k times n bits, the key to have really, really hard problems. Yeah, and in fact, most of the problems that we address today, they are NP-hard. So we don't, since we do cryptanalysis, we usually don't have a chance to have polynomial algorithms. So we have to stay in the exponential algorithm area. So coding theorists usually look at the parity check matrix, which is a kernel of this generator matrix G. So it's a matrix A, which sends every code word to the zero vector. And the dimension of this H here is a codimension n minus k. Yeah. So, and what we are concerned with during this talk is first in the beginning only random codes. So we are looking at random, either random generator matrix or a random parity check matrices. This is actually the same. And usually these random codes are very hard instances for decoding. So they are in fact known to be NP-hard. And the crypto motivation is where you have more structured codes like Gopher codes in the Michaelis system is that you scramble these codes by two operations, S and T, these are both matrices, and then they look somehow random, right? And we will also discuss practical applications where we solve actually practical instantiations of Michaelis type crypto systems, for instance, and there we also have random codes, so random matrices here. So it's a very good generic hardness criterion where we can test our algorithms on. And as I said, one of the main motivations here is NIST round 3 submission, classical Michaelis, which is currently one of the four encryption schemes that is one of the finalists in the selection process. Okay, so here from this slide, you already know two parameters of a code. So there's the dimension of the subspace, which is K, the dimension of the code, and then the length of the code, which is N. Yeah, and we map to length N by the generator matrix. Okay, so there's, unfortunately, there's also a third parameter in codes. And the third parameter is the distance of a code, and this is defined here. So the distance is, I take every pair of code words, which are distinct, which are not the same, and then I look at the Hamming distance between those. Yeah. And so the Hamming distance is the number of positions where they differ, and I take the minimum of all of them. Yeah, and you can think of the code words distributed in the space 2 to the n, and they are separated by distance at least d. So if I blow up Hamming balls around these points, then they don't intersect as long as the Hamming balls have a radius of d minus 1/2. Yeah, so d 1/2, say first intersect. But if we are in this decoding radius d minus 1/2, then if I give you a code word plus some error, it has a unique, so there's a unique code word C where it decodes to. And this is a setting which we usually have in crypto, right? So this is the main problem that we addressed during the whole talk. So please understand this problem. So here's a parity check matrix, H. We are given a code word plus an error, which is called X. And we know that the error is within this decoding range, d minus 1/2. And our goal is actually to decode X. So that means to decode to C, but you can see it's equivalent to finding the error E. And once we have the error E, then we can actually add this error again to the X. And then we end up with C. So adding and subtracting is the same since we are in F2. Yeah, and now the syndrome decoding problem that we address here with our algorithms in the first part of this talk is the following. We compute a syndrome as H times this X. So this is the given input for our BD problem, bounded distance decoding problem. So X is C plus E. So this is all linear. So we have that. And we know, well, this is a kernel, this H matrix. So this is the zero vector here. So we have rest with H times E. Yeah, and you already see it's kind of a linear algebra problem. Yeah, we know the syndrome S that we can compute from H and X. We know this parity check matrix H, but we don't know E. So the problem is to find an E of small weight such that the columns defined by E, yeah, the columns of H defined by E sum up to S. That's our problem. That's our syndrome decoding problem. And you will see these are in large, quite large dimensions. So so for instance, the N that we address later in Michaelis is around 1200. So we have more than 1200 columns of these, and we want to find those maybe 20 something columns set sum to a certain S here. Okay, and this is our problem in crypto, but when you design algorithms, there's one more thing, then you, well, okay, so first of all, I should say now we have three parameters, right? We have N, K, and D, which makes this problem already a little bit more complicated than usual problems that we have. Like, so for compare, for instance, with RSA, where we have one parameter, the length of the modulus, and then we determine how hard it is to factor, or for discrete log, where we have one parameter for the order of the discrete log, and that's it. And here we have already three parameters, and this is kind of uncomfortable for cryptanalysts, so we want to get rid of one parameter, and this is what I do on the next slide. Yeah, so I want to get rid of this D, and I look at the worst case instances of decoding, and I told you these are random codes. And now any running time of a decoding algorithm is a function of these code parameters N, K, and D. And now I look at this map. Yeah, I send the error to the syndrome HE. And now I look at the full decoding instance. Yeah, this is really, so the delta of E is not D minus 1/2, but D. And I pretend that this map can only be injective if N over D is smaller than 2 to the N minus K, right? And then I get a relation of all of these three parameters. Right, I can approximate this N over D by an entropy function, and this eventually gives me this, what is called Gilbert-Varshamov bound. So you don't really have to understand what's going on here, but all that you have to understand is that in random codes, D, N, and K are linked by this equation. So basically I can solve now for D, and then I get a function of N and K. Yeah. Okay, so this is sharp for random codes, I'm sorry. And this links us D to N and K, and the running time becomes now a function of N and K. And the way we express these running times, these are NP-hard problems, so we expect exponential size, exponential algorithms only. So the T is a function of N and K, and I write it in this form, 2 to some function K over N, which is called the rate of a code times N. Yeah. Okay, so the function of in this really random setting is the function of our two code parameters where we abstracted away the distance of the code. Yeah, and then we want to get rid of the second parameter, the K, we take the max over all these running times. Yeah, this looks a little bit complicated, but look at the next slide. So remember this here is the rate K over N. And this is what I have on the x-axis here. So K over N, so K is the dimension of the subspace, this is smaller than N. So the K must, the rate must be between 0 and 1. And this is so typical parameters for the running time that I have here. And here I have the exponent. This is, if I go back, this is this exponent here, F of the rate of this, right? Okay, and you already see, okay, no matter how the rate is, so worst case rates are usually around 1/2, actually a little bit smaller than this for some reason. Yeah, it's not symmetric, about 1/2, but they are around 1/2, they are the hardest instances. And you see here in this example already what the exponent is about, right? So the exponent is about 0.05, which is something like 1 over 20. So our running times for decoding algorithms will be around 2 to the n over 20. Yeah, this is the running times that we achieve. And I will give you a little bit of examples for algorithms that achieve these running times. And we only care about the top point here, the maximum overall rates of this. Right? Okay. So are there any questions so far? Or I measure running time and so on. Yeah, because here are some examples of running times. You see they are around 1 over 20, you know, this 0.05, something like this. And here's the first one, and this is the most famous one, and we'll discuss this during this talk. It's an algorithm called Pranger. Yeah, it's from the 60s, early 60s, and the complexity is around 1 over 21, something like this. No, it's 1 over, I'm sorry, it's 1 over 17 around, 1 over 17. Yeah, and we'll kind of see how this, where this complexity comes from. This is actually very easy to analyze. The others I won't really analyze, I just give it, give them to you. So then there was an improvement in the late 80s by Stern, which is around 1 over 18. And then there's this algorithm called MMT, which I will also present you shortly today. I'm sorry for this. MMT stands for Mai, Moira, and Tome from AsiaCrypt 11. And this is 1 over 19, roughly. And then there's the BGMM, which is currently often considered the standard, which is about 1 over 20. And then there's my Osterov, which is actually asymptotically better, which is roughly 1 over 21. Yeah, this is the way to go. But as I told you, I just go with the simple algorithms. Right? Any questions so far? If not, then I go on. So let's just start to think a little bit about this problem. So remember, the problem was as follows. We are given a parity check matrix H, and we are given a syndrom S here. And we are looking for a vector E, which has small weight. So I see there's one question. The values of slide 6 are for which values of K and N? Yeah, they are actually for the worst case values, right? So if I go back, here, then these are kind of the top points here. So actually they can reach their top for different rates, but the rates are around 0.45 to 0.5, something like this, right? And you can consider this as maybe the Prandtl complexity, and this is Stern, and this is maybe Mayer-Osterov, something like this. Okay, good. Yeah, this is important to understand because we want to abstract from too many graphs and so on. So we just give one point just to make it easy to compare things. Okay, so let's start with a very first and simple algorithm. So assume throughout this talk that we know the weight of the error vector. So usually in Michaelis instances, you know this weight and it's kind of smallish. Huh? So for the things that we attack, it's around 20 something. For real parameters, it's around 50. So it's really smallish. And then we do an exhaustive search. Yeah, we are given the parity check matrix. We are given the X from which we can compute the syndrome as H times X. And we are given the weight. And then we enumerate all potential error vectors with such a small weight. Yeah, and the way we check is once we have a candidate for E, we check whether parity matrix times E is actually our syndrome, which we compute as H times X. Yeah, and if you do that, then you end up with complexity N choose this omega, which is quite large, right? It's not 1 over 20, it's more 1 over 3. Yeah, so it seems to be that exhaustive search is not super clever, yeah? But there's a simple, clever linear algebra trick that helps you. And this is what we do on the next slide. So let's look at our allowed transformation that we can do by linear algebra for this equation here. So the first observation is we can do column permutations. So if I write this equation here, H times E, I can also multiply by a permutation matrix here and by the inverse here, so nothing happens. And this is still the same. And now take brackets here, H times P and P minus 1 over E. So that means we are actually permuting the columns of H. No, this is one operation that we can do. And this leaves S unchanged, yeah, because we work only on H. And the other operation is we can do elementary row operations. So we take, let's say, Gaussian elimination, for instance, here on from the left. And then we have to do the same on the right-hand side. So we also apply it to the syndrome, and that gives us some syndrome S prime. Yeah, and this is an invertible transformation for these matrices. And there are very easy special cases of this. So once is H is actually a square matrix, then if we can invert it, so let's say it has full rank, then it's easy to compute an E, right? Because there's a unique E that satisfies this equation here. So it's the inverse of H times S. And another thing is that it's also easy, And this is also an important observation. It's easy to solve this equation if you don't have this small weight restriction. So in fact, for any weight, I can do the following. I compute Gaussian elimination of this matrix. So let's say I eliminate the last n minus k rows here and take a unit matrix here. And then I end up with some h prime here in front, which has k columns now. And now you can see that you can easily solve this. So this gives you a new syndrome g times s. And how do you solve this now? Well, so as the first k coordinates of E, I can simply take the zero coordinates and these multiply by h prime. And then I kind of read off the last coordinates of Gs because I have a unit matrix here. So I have to choose the last n minus k coordinates of this E such that they match this Gs. Yeah. So and in general, that means I can always find not only one solution, but I can always find on expectation one solution which has weight n minus k half. Right, because if I do a Gaussian elimination on S, and I would expect that half of the bits are one, the other half are zero. So I have to set half of the bits in the last n minus k coordinates of E to one, and that's my solution. Yeah, but in principle, our weight will be much smaller, and the hardness of this problem really comes from having an undefined system and the small weight restriction. Yeah, this is what makes it really hard and combinatorial. But still, you already see that the linear algebra seems to help you a lot, right? In finding somehow larger weight solutions or something. And in fact, this last observation here is already the key to Prange's algorithm. Okay, so think of this again, of this any weight thing. And now go to this famous Prange algorithm from the 60s. And this is the most packed slide. So if you understand this, then the rest of the talk will be very, very easy. Okay, so what we do now is, as before, we split the E in two parts. Yeah, so the first has dimension K and is multiplied by this H prime. And the second has dimension E2. Yeah, and before I told you, we fix E1 to the all zero vector. And that's already a very good intuition for Prange's algorithm. But now let's assume that it has an arbitrary weight. So what we end up now, because this is a unit matrix, I end up with H times H prime times E1 plus E2 is our transformed syndrome S prime. And now this algorithm of Prange does the following. It first does our permutation of columns with our permutation matrix, and then the Gaussian elimination. So these are exactly the two steps that we had before. Yeah, we first do this step column permutation and then Gaussian elimination. And our hope is that we permute the columns such that this E1 here gets very small weight. Yeah, so basically almost all of the ones go to this part here. Yeah, and E1 has very small weight. Okay, and the weight of E1 is supposed to be some p, some optimization parameter, which is smaller than the weight. And now we enumerate all E1s of dimension k with this weight p. Yeah, and this p you have to remember during the whole talk, this plays an important role in all these information set decoding algorithms. Yeah, these are called information set decoding algorithms. And okay, so I enumerate over all of these guys, and for every candidate, I check now the following. I have to check this equation, that this equation holds. And now I basically solve it for E2. So if I solve it for E2, then E2 is H prime E1 plus S prime. This is my E2. And since I spent weight P on this E1, I have to spend the remaining weight here on E2, and the remaining weight is omega minus p. Yeah, and once I find an E2, which is of this form, and then I know that E1 and E2 together, they have the right weight, omega, and I'm done. Yeah, and eventually I have to undo the permutation here. Yeah, I have to take p minus 1 of this permutation here. This is on my E2, and then I find the E. Okay, so what's the complexity of this algorithm? So this outer loop here, this shifts our weight, right? So what we want to have is we want on the k part of the, on the E1 part, we want, which is of dimension k, we want to have weight p. And on the n minus k part, we want to have the remaining weight of omega minus p. And this is this amount of the total amount of permutations. And the inner loop is just an enumeration over all E1 of weight P, and this is K choose P. Yeah. So I have to take the inverse of this because this is a probability, but the expected run-in time is the inverse of this. And then I have to multiply it by K times P, and then K choose P cancels out. And the total running time is like this. It's really not hard to see that this running time is actually optimized in Prange's algorithm if I don't take any p in the inner loop. Yeah. So what Prange's algorithm actually does is shifting all the way to E2 and then check whether this E2, this actually goes away, E1 has weight one, whether the S prime that I obtain has a right weight of omega. This is a very trivial algorithm, this Prange algorithm. And if you do that, then you already end up with this running time 1/17 n. And the cool thing, it also has constant memory because it's just permutation and Gauss elimination until you eventually find the right key, right? And maybe a crucial observation here is that the complexity of this whole thing, it comes fully from the permutations, yeah, from step one. I do permutations all the time, then I do some Gaussian elimination, but that's only polynomial time. And then I check whether this permutation was actually right by checking this this condition here. Yeah. And this this optimization here of p is equal to one, it tells us we should do no enumeration at all because it doesn't pay off. Yeah, and you might ask this question now, which is here in the bottom line, who introduced this stupid P? So why did I choose this P at all? Because we don't need it, right? I could have given you this Prange algorithm without this stupid P and it would have been fine. So the key observation is, if you don't do the step two here in a very naive way in enumerating these guys by brute force search, but if you do it more cleverly, then the step two gains more and more importance as opposed to the step one here of the permutations. So this is the key of all the improvements that we have for this ISD algorithms. And you have seen there were many, many improvements within the last decade. And all of these improvements are actually improvements for the step one, where we do a clever enumeration. And this allows us to choose larger and larger p's in these algorithms. Yeah. So is there any question at this point? Because I think it's important that you understand this Prange algorithm. Okay, seems not. So I can go on. Okay, so so now I said, okay, we want to improve upon this step two. This was brute force search, so we can do another meet in the middle stuff. Yeah, so maybe we split E1 in two parts, as you do in usual meet in the middle algorithm, and then you enumerate each part, and then you match, blah blah blah. And this is called the Stern algorithm. So this is from the late 80s. So what you do now is you split the matrix H in two parts, both of a dimension k half. So you get an H1 and H2. You split your E now in three parts, dimension k half, and n minus k, and then you get this equation here. Yeah. So you have an E1 now and an E2, and the E3 is the one that you get kind of for free because it's related to this identity matrix here. And again, you get this the syndrome S prime here. So what you do now is you again permute as before, you construct a systematic form, you fix some weight here, and now you split it in half. So you enumerate over all E of dimension K half, which only have weight P half. And then you store all these H1s, E1s in a sorted list. And you do the same for all H2s, E2 with dimension k half, also of weight p half. Yeah, you store them in this list plus S prime, and then you see, well, this is the first list, oops, then H2E2 plus S prime is the second list, so they should differ by this E3. Yeah, and this is what you do in the fourth step. You search for elements in L1, L2 such that they differ by the right weight, namely the weight that you haven't spent. So far you spent a weight P distributed in P half and P half. So the remaining weight is omega minus P, and this is the difference. And actually this is a non-trivial step. Yeah. So you have very large lists now constructed in step 1, 2, 3. And then you have to find matching elements up to a small distance in Hamming weight. And I don't tell you how this is done, but there's a lot of algorithmic tricks that was going on there. So for instance, this Mayer-Osorov, the latest improvement that I told you, it's mainly an improvement of this matching. Okay, and then it's the same. Yeah. So then you find E and you undo the permutation and so on. Yeah, so originally in Stern, he did the step 4 by doing a projection on L coordinates, and this is what you find in some records, how people do that, but in theory you can do better. So, but anyway, so you improve a little bit over Prange's algorithm now, so you end up with 2 to the 1 over 18 times n, but you also have to sacrifice in memory because you have to store larger lists here. And I will come to this memory point again. And now it's no longer true that you should choose P equal to 0, right? Because otherwise you could not improve on this running time. Yeah. So, okay. And there are further improvements on this meet in the middle. And behind most of these improvements is a technique that was introduced by Haukrauer, Graham, and Zhu in 2010, and it's called the representation technique. And I just want to give you a glimpse in this talk what this representation technique is. So a usual meet in the middle is the following. You split your E as E1 and E2 having half of the dimension, as we did before. Yeah. So they have half of the dimension, k half, and E is of k. And they also have half of the weight, yeah, p half. And then once you have E1 and E2, it's trivial to combine them. You just concatenate them and you get back E. And a trivial observation is also that there's a unique representation of your secret E in terms of E1 and E2 because you simply split them in half. Yeah. So what is a representation now? So in a representation, you write E actually as a sum of E1 and E2. Not a concatenation of vectors, but as sum of two vectors, both having full dimension k, and their weight is also p half. Yeah. And now is you combine E1 and E2 via addition in F2 to the k. And we have to be careful, yeah, that also can cause some problems, because if I add two vectors, E1 and E2, I could also add up once maybe in some positions. But anyway, we'll come back to these problems. So one of the advantages of this representation is now E has many representations as a sum. Yeah, and here's an example. So if I have a vector of length 8 and weight 4, so this is my E here, then I can represent it in many ways as a vector of as a sum of two vectors. So for instance, I could choose the first two ones here and put them in E1, and the second two ones here and put them in E2. Yeah, but I could also choose the first one and the third one and put it in E1, and the second and the fourth and put it there. So in total, actually, you see it's determined by the number of ways that I can distribute the ones. I have distribute out of this 4 ones, 2 to the first vector and 2 to the second vector. So I get 4 choose 2 possibilities, and this is 6 possibilities, and these are the 6 possibilities that I wrote you here. Okay. So I consider this as an advantage, but let's discuss what that means. Yeah, if I split it in this way, because also you see now, I mean, one of the advantages here in splitting it in half was that the dimension decreased, which is not longer true for these representations, and as you will see on the next slide. So if I split in full dimension of this weight, then I have basically two disadvantages. The list sizes that I obtain, they are much larger now. Yeah? Before they were k over 2, choose p over 2, and now they increase to k over k choose p over 2, which is way larger. Yeah, and another problem is I split in two vectors, e1 and e2, both having a weight p half. But if I add them, then usually their sum has having weight smaller than p, because there could be one positions that add up and then they decrease the weight, right? So unless I have the one positions in distinct positions, I decrease the weight, yeah? Which is not something that happens if I split in the middle. If I split in the middle, then I have p half here and p half here, and I concatenate and I have automatically the right weight. Okay, but one advantage is, as we already saw in our example, we have now p o choose p half representations as a sum of this. So the idea of this algorithm is now, so since our search space now increases L1 and L2 from this guy to this guy, we also shrink it again, yeah? Because we have now R representations, and these are also exponentially many representations here in this form. I can consider only in 1/r fraction of these lists, yeah? And let's say we do it somehow randomly, yeah? It's not what we do, in fact, but let's assume that. Then we would expect that if we shrink these lists by this factor, then they still contain one sum E1, E2, which is a representation of the C. Yeah. And kind of a thing is, if you have many solutions, often in cryptanalysis, it's easier to construct a special one. So this is what we do. We are actually looking for entries of list L1, this is here, and list L2, that match on the last log 1/r coordinates to 0, yeah? And remember, so before we had this this size here, k over 2 choose p over 2, and now we have a larger search space, k choose p over 2, but we shrinked it by r, by p or choose p over 2. And we can have an advantage if this left-hand side here is smaller than the right-hand side, which actually happens, yeah? And that's where we get this improvement, this 1/19n. Okay, so this is representations, and this was used many times since then. And let's get back to this second disadvantage, yeah? If I have two vectors, E1 and E2, and I add them up, then there could be one position that add up, and then I have smaller weight, yeah? And this disadvantage turns out to be actually an advantage in the on the next slide. So this is this algorithm of Beckerjou, Meyer, and Moira called BGMM algorithm in the literature. So what you choose here is you choose your E1 and E2 with a weight which is slightly larger than p half. And then you hope that actually, so the slightly larger means some epsilon, and then you hope that among these epsilon position, among the added positions, there are epsilon positions where you have a 1+1 and they cancel, and then you get on expectation the weight p again. Yeah, why is that good? Well, before we were kind of only representing ones. Yeah, I told you you have to distribute the one either to the first vector, so it's a 1+0, or to the second vector, so it's a 0+1. But now we have even more representations as before, right? Now we could also represent our zeros as 0+0 as before, or also 1+1 in these additional epsilon positions that we have. And this is kind of the key to a further improvement. And well, this is how the paper was called, this BGMM paper, how 1+1 is 0 improves information set decoding. So at that point, we found that actually very funny. I'm not sure whether we still do. Okay, so and then you improve to this 1/20, yeah? And again, this observation I told you for Prange, it's a case that all the complexity stems from the outer loop, from the permutation, and you shouldn't do a weight inside. So there was no enumeration. And if you do BGMM, and also with my Osorov, it's even worse. Then if you compute this complexity, this one n over 20, then almost all complexity shifts to the enumeration because it's now much better than before and you shouldn't do so many permutations. Yeah, so this n2 to the n over 20 is basically all an enumeration and not permutation. So that means your p inside the loop should be actually quite large. Yeah, this is what theory predicts us, but this is all also asymptotics. Yeah, and I will come to this point now if you want to really attack Michaelis. Okay, how am I doing in time? Oh, looks good. Okay, so here's a word about memory. I already told you that in Prangr, the memory increases. So forget about this full distance decoding. We are in the bounded distance decoding setting here. So for Prangr, we had basically polynomial space. So Stern increased the memory and all these other algorithms, so ball collision, that's one of Bernstein et al. Bernstein-Lange et al. And then there's this MMT and it also has increased space and BGMM also has increased space. So from the theory side, you would say, okay, time is still way larger than space, so everything is fine. But we also come to practice in a few seconds, and then in practice, it really plays a role how large your space consumption is. Okay, so this is about memory. And now the question, and this is still ongoing, is how good is this improvement, right? So when we wrote this MMT paper and BGMM paper, it's very theory. Huh? So it's asymptotic, we use this Gilbert-Varshamov bound, we don't care about polynomial factors and so on. And there are lots of actually polynomial factors in this algorithms. And then these two guys here, Hamdawi and Sondrier, they also did some non-asymptotic analysis of information set decoding like ATSB4. And here are kind of typical Michaelis parameters. And they came to the conclusion that for these parameters, the new algorithms like MMT and BGMM, they should actually improve the complexity. So these are bit complexities. So and throughout this talk, they are now bit complexities. So this should be read as 2 to the 55.61 and so on. Yeah. But once you come to this business, to these estimates, it's also very risky business, right? Because then how do you take these polynomial factors into account, blah, blah, blah. Which data structure do you use? Can you improve that? But it already gave some indication that actually the break-even point for these improved algorithms like MMT and BGMM is within the range of cryptographic parameters. But still, this is an ongoing discussion, yeah? So here's the conclusion was, it's relevant for cryptographic key sizes. And for Mai-Osorov, it was not clear where the breakpoint is. So maybe it's even larger outside for even larger dimensions than 4,000. Still, it's not very clear because it has a huge polynomial factors. So that's why I ignore it for the rest of this talk. And now there's a lot of discussion. So for instance, if you consider now Michaelis, then actually they are not in the setting where we are. So we worked with this Gilbert-Varshamov bound where D is actually a constant of N. So it's theta of N. Whereas for Michaelis, D is really small. So well, really small means for Michaelis, it's slightly sublinear in N. And that actually makes a difference for the asymptotic analysis of our MMT and BGMM algorithm. And if you do the analysis, then you still get some improvement asymptotically, but they are second order term in the exponent. Yeah, and then that's why the authors of the Michaelis-Smith submission currently argue, well, MMT and BGMM is there, we know them, but we shouldn't care about them because eventually they fall back to Prangr. Yeah, all improvement that they give are small over one terms. And so we shouldn't consider them, which is an oversimplification, right? And now there's really a lot of cumbersome debate on the NIST PQC forum, whether these actually underestimate the security. And actually today in the morning, I read something on this PQC forum by Ray Pöllner from NIST, and he said, so look, it seems that McAleese really underestimates things by taking only Prange. But I want to argue that during this talk that they also overestimate because they take Prange without the polynomial factors, and eventually it seems that they are kind of right. So this is actually what our experiments tell us. Yeah. So I don't want to do this estimate business. So there's a lot of these things going on currently at TII. So for instance, Andre, Miss Emma and others are actually writing an estimator, which kind of accurately estimates what's going on. And this is, I think, very useful. But I want to go more into detail of what we did in practice now, right? And really one of the questions is, how useful are these new algorithms in practice? Okay, so here's one record that we broke in this May, so like 2 months ago. And this is currently the record for McAleese. So the length N is 1223, and the weight D is 23. And the K is 979, and this was done by Andre Floyd and myself. And this the complexity of this guy was estimated as, I'm sorry, as a bit as bit complexity 54. It took 3 days on our computing cluster, but I have to admit that our computing cluster is also quite powerful. So this corresponds to roughly 4 CPU years. So it's not outrageous, but it's already some time. Yeah. Okay. So what Andre's estimates told us that in theory, you should use quite a large P if you use like MMT or BGMM. I don't quite remember the P that he estimated, but it was like maybe something around 16 or so. But in practice, our P, so this is what we enumerate in this enumeration part, in the K part, was only 4. Yeah, and this 4 actually gives us very few representations, right? As you remember, in my example, I also had 4, which was like six representations for choose 2. So it's very few representations, but it's also not nothing. Yeah. So if we would have computed this with Prange's algorithm only, then it would have taken much longer than these 3 days. Yeah. And what we also found out, and which was also kind of clear to many people before, is our hardware or our implementation, it's not so clear but what it is, actually doesn't like memory consumption so much, right? So if we increase the P, we also get larger lists and so on. And this severely punishes us in the running time. So for our instance, it was really optimal to choose a small P. Okay, so what we also did is we interpolated to the McAleese NIST parameters, which are dimension like, I don't know, 4,000 to 6,000, something like this. And it actually supports their security claims. So despite what is going on this PQC forum at the moment, we cannot really tell. So despite the fact that we are kind of using representations and all the new stuff, it still seems that if we want to be in the small memory regime somehow, the NIST parameters look quite good. They are at least as hard as they are predicted by the authors. And currently we are doing the next challenge. Yeah? So the next challenge has an estimate of 56. So it's supposed to be like 4 times as hard as this. So hopefully we can solve it in around, I don't know, 12 days or so. Okay, so this is not the only thing that we did, not only for McAleese, but we also looked at BIKE and HQC, which are based on circulant calls. I don't want to go into the details of this, but you see here we have more records than for McAleese. So actually we also improved the length of the records significantly. So before, the oldest record was about 1900. And now we improved by a dimension almost 1,000. These codes have a rate of 1/2. So they are kind of a worst case instances, but also kind of smallish weight. But if you look compared to McAleese, it's also kind of impressive rate here. Okay, so basically we use the same implementation as before, and the running time here for the largest is also comparable. It's also about 3 days on our cluster. We added new tricks for using the cyclic structure of these codes. And one of the observations that we did is our polynomial speedups that we did here, they matter a lot in practice. Okay, so all I want to say for this. So now I have 5 minutes left. But I'm also done with the coding part. And if you don't mind, I would do a short, very short lattice part now. Okay. So because I want to consider now jumping from codes to lattices, I want to consider the similarity of codes to lattices. Yeah. So here's a so-called ternary LWE problem. And this is actually used for constructing basically all of the other encryption schemes that we have currently as final candidates in the NIST list. So like Entru or Kaiba and also Sabre and also signature schemes like PLIS and GLP. So what do you do in this ternary LWE problem? You are given a matrix A, and this A is now no longer an F2, but in set Q. So we get a fourth parameter Q now. You are given a B, and you know that A times S for some secret S is B up to a small error. Yeah, and now both are small in L infinity norm. So S and E are both ternary vectors with entries in 0 ± 1. Yeah, some of these instances like Kuiper, they also take ±2, but let's keep ternary vectors for now. And you can also generalize to larger vectors, but it's more cumbersome. And your goal is to find this S. Yeah, and usually people say, okay, look, this is now a lattice problem. This has nothing to do with this decoding stuff. And I want to tell you that this is actually not the truth. So if you want to formulate it in decoding language, then you could write it in parity check form as this, right? So you multiply here, this matrix here, A times S minus E is B, and that's it. Yeah, it now lives in FQ, that's fine, but it's also a decoding, and it's as before, it's a random code. Yeah, A is random. There is a unit matrix, but as we have already seen, I can always bring this in this form by doing Gaussian elimination. So what we have to do is now we have this parity check matrix here. We have a syndrome here. We have to find somehow this error vector here. Yeah, and for LWE, it's also kind of easier here because it suffices kind of to find E. Yeah? So E we get for free, but this is also similar to before, right? So the second part we got for free. So let us look at the most simple algorithms for solving this problem. So assume that S is a random vector in 0 ± 1 to the n. And later we also consider small weights, so smaller numbers of plus minus ones. So brute forces, we enumerate all S's, and then we check whether AS minus B is actually the error vector E. So it lives in 0 ± 1 to the n. And of course, the time complexity to enumerate all these S's is 3 to the n. And as before, you can now do a meet in the middle split. So you split S in 2/2, you split A in 2/2, and you check whether A1 times S1 is approximately minus A2 S2 up to the error vector E. Yeah, and the time complexity becomes roughly the square root of this. So it's 3 to the n/2. And now it's kind of natural, right? You remember for codes, we had this meet in the middle. Now you can do this representation trick again. And so you split S as a sum of S1 and S2, full length N, half the weight roughly. And what you can show roughly is that you get, instead of the second root, you get the fourth root of this space. Yeah. And I will show you what that means on the next slide. And I will also compare to what lattices do. Yeah, here I have N-true, typical N-true instances. So this is the N. Remember, A was an N by N matrix. We live over set Q, and Q is a power of 2 for efficiency reasons. And now I have a weight here. Yeah, so this weight W means I choose the secret vector as a vector of dimension 659, such that exactly 38 components are plus 1 and 38 components are minus 1. So in total, we have 76 components plus minus 1. Yeah, so this is the notion here. And this is the current N-true standard, IEEE 2008. Yeah, here I denote the search space. Yeah, if I just enumerate all these vectors, so it's 6, 5, 9, choose, well, the weight of 1s, the weight of minus 1s, and the weight of zeros, and then I get a search space of 408 bit. Yeah, and if you do this algorithm that I described here in this paper from Crypto this year, which will be presented at Crypto this year, then you do it concretely, you end up with this. So I promised you that you get the fourth root of the search space, which is not quite true, because the fourth root of the search space would be around 100 bit, but you have to do some extra guessing and stuff. But look, if you compare to current lattice estimates, so for enumeration of lattices, also with core SVP, blah, blah, blah. So really the best that you can do for lattices, you see that this combinatorial approach actually improves over lattices in this regime. Yeah, and this is true for all the parameters of the standard. So we don't really get the fourth root. So the root is more 0.35 as denoted here for these guys. But these guys are all better than the SVP estimates. And also for the third one, for instance, this instance is supposed to give you 256-bit security. So this attack here really violates this security claim of the old N-true standard. But if you look, for instance, at the new N-true standard, which was proposed to NIST now, there's a little bit of a difference. So the wise thing that they did is they increased the weight kind of dramatically. Yeah? So here I give the relative weight. So this has relative weight 1/2. So meaning 127 entries are each plus minus 1. And now you see it flips. Yeah, so this is really bad for our algorithm. So we still get kind of a good root of the search space. So the root is even better, it's 0.3 roughly, yeah, of the search space. But we are way a tad bit away from what you can do with SVP algorithms, so with lattice enumeration. So, and as I told you, asymptotically, we achieve something like this, meaning that n goes to infinity. Okay, and the observation that you should get from this table is here. So the hardness, if you take this new algorithm, the hardness for this enumeration algorithm, it really comes from the weight. If I have a small relative weight, then everything is fine and we are better than lattices. Whereas the hardness for lattices, it really comes from the dimension of the lattice, right? So here you don't really, I mean, so look for instance at this instance, it's kind of comparable dimension to this here, yeah? The first for the IEEE standard 2008 and the second for the NIST standard. Yeah? They have comparable dimensions. And if you look at lattices, they do not really differ in the complexity. Here it's 151 and here it's 167. Okay, so what? So it's about the same. But if you look at the enumeration algorithm, it's kind of double, right? So it was really a wise decision of the guys from the new NIST proposal to increase the weight such that you kind of guard against this enumeration. It seems they kind of anticipated these improved combinatorial algorithms. And if you look actually into the submissions, then they actually talk about it. So they said that they expect that combinatorial algorithms improve, and that's why they choose larger weight. So that was a clever decision. So that brings me to wrap up this talk. So you have seen for decoding, there were improvements, well, asymptotically, but also maybe in practice. In theory, I would say they are quite significant, but currently less so in practice. So we could use some of them in practice. They also give us a certain kind of speedups in practice, but not so much. But some of the techniques are also not actually included in the records in our records in practice. Some are, and we are still trying to get better algorithms to break more records on this decodingchallenge.org page. But yet the conclusion is also current security estimates for McAleese, they seem to be valid. No, that's what we can tell by our experimental stuff. And if you go to lattices, then I would say that these techniques carry over to lattices once you have kind of small search spaces. Yeah, so you have limited your secrets as ternary, for instance, and you don't have too much weight, and then these techniques carry over. And I also want to say that, in my opinion, the complexity estimates for enumeration, they are much more stable than those that we have for lattices. Yeah? So for lattices, these estimates, they come off of estimates. So I used some estimators of Martin Albrecht and others, and also of Leo Dukas. But there's a lot of heuristics inside this. So there's GSA, blah, 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 blah. Whereas here for the enumeration, I have to compute list sizes. This I can do very precisely. So there's almost no heuristics in this algorithm, so they can be considered very stable. Okay. So, and one of the observations is maybe lattice schemes, they are not as different as people wish, right? So we have like four schemes now for encryption. Three are lattices, one is codes, but after all, they are all very similar, right? In a certain sense, they are all abstractions of the McAleese crypto system. Yeah, and this was also noted by Regev. Yeah, Regev said they are all like, you can consider them all also as coding systems if you wish, but over larger fields. But yet again, the current security estimate seems to be valid. Yeah? So there's no invalidation of this. Also, we have better attacks now. And one of the open questions for me, this is what I had in mind when I was designing this new thing for lattices as well, is there a hybrid of this combinatorial and lattices? So for now, you have this combinatorial. It's good in a very small weight area. And then you have lattices, which are kind of good in a small dimension area. And maybe there's a hybrid between these two. So a combining algorithm such that you don't have to distinguish, you are now in this regime where you have to use enumeration, and you are in this regime where you have lattices. So that's all. I want to thank you very much. And I also want to excuse for overrunning like 5 minutes, but I'm happy to take questions.
No worries. Thanks a lot for the nice talk, Alex. It was very interesting. I don't think any question. I don't see any. Oh, there is a question from
There's a question by Juan. Is there any bound for weight in the remark of the slide A? Eight, let's see. Yeah, here you mean, okay. So here it's any weight. Well, any weight is maybe a little bit confusing, right? So what I can do is I can choose the first K coordinates of E as I wish. And then I kind of get by this identity matrix, I get the last coordinates for free, and then I get a certain weight. And if I do the most clever algorithm that we did in the talk was to choose the weight of E arbitrary zero in the first K coordinates, and then you would expect getting weight n minus k here for E. So if you apply, for instance, this algorithm to McAleese instance, just to give you an example, I don't know whether this answers your question, you have to tell me in a minute. So look at a Michaelis instance that we broke, for instance. Yeah, so here you have n minus k is around 240, something like this. Yeah? So it would be easy for this instance to get a solution of weight 240 divided by 2. So it's 120. But you see that the solution that we are heading for is only 23. Yeah, so it's easy to get 120, but it's actually hard to get 23. Yeah, this is maybe an example where you see that getting a little bit larger weight is really super easy, but getting this is hard, hopefully for crypto. Does it answer your question? Seems so. And now there's a question by Sergi. Since polynomial improvements seem to matter in practice, do you think that the difficulty of translating each particular classical algorithm to a quantum enhanced version should be taken into account when choosing a post-quantum alternative? Yeah, that's a very good question, right? So we are always talking about post-quantum stuff, and then we analyze everything in the classical setting. And it seems to me maybe that even in the classical setting, we don't really understand what's going on, right? And a kind of the same discussion that is going on for the classical is also going on for quantum. So there are quantum versions of MMT, of BGMM, and so on. But some of you would maybe say that the improvements classically are not super large. For me, they are kind of, but some of you would say, well, if it's 1 over 17 to 1 over 21, is it really super large? Mm-hmm. If you go to the quantum world, they are even less impressive, right? And then you have to do quantum walks and a lot of quantum memory and so on. And that's maybe a good argument also in favor of Michaelis, right? So if you kind of believe that the simple Prangr algorithm, yeah, that we already had on slide 8, so it took us like 20 minutes to understand this Prangr algorithm, that this is really the best that you can do in practice, kind of, there's an easy quantum version of this Prangr algorithm, which is due to Bernstein, and then you get the square root of this quantumly, and then you are fine. So it seems to me at the moment that this is actually reasonable to do in practice, yeah? And I mean, people are now arguing on this PQC from that we don't really understand the complexity of Michaelis. I would like to disagree on this. I think we understand it perfectly, right? We have very good algorithms. We have also kind of good quantum versions, yeah? At least a quantum version of Prangr. And I think that we actually understand a little bit less of what's going on for lattices, because it's also harder, right? It's this field comes into play, and we have to understand how this Q actually comes into play for the complexity. It's not so super easy. I don't know whether this answers your question. I have to go back to the question. Yeah, so as I said, so these polynomial factors really matter in practice if we implement it. So the drawback for quantum is we cannot really run it in practice at the moment, right? Maybe it makes sense to also analyze them a little bit theoretically, but in practice, I mean, there's no practice for quantum algorithms so far.